Our hymn of celebration this morning is 577. Please stand as you are able and join us in singing.
Thank you.
please remain standing as we unite in the historic confession of the Christian Church? I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us prepare our hearts for prayer. One of the easiest ways, O God, that we can fall away in our faith, to lose our sight of you, is to try to bend your will to our will, to try to manipulate your purpose for our own purpose. Lord, we pray that over the next few moments, as we join men and women and boys and girls from around the world today and the days to come, worshiping you, we pray that our minds and our spirits would be repositioned and reminded of your faithfulness and your love. So that God, as a result, in one way, what we could see as a result is our confidence in you becomes stronger. Our trust in you becomes stronger. Ultimately, O God, where we find ourselves bending our will towards yours, where we start melding the two together, but what changes, O God, is our own desires and our own heart's ambition. I guess, O God, what I cry out for myself and those, O God, who is here and who can hear my voice today, is that you would melt us and mold us into what you want, not what we want. And that constant reminder would be that you are ours and we are yours. Oh God, may that bring glory to your name, and may that affect us in the days to come, where we as individuals, as families, further your kingdom and tell of your wonderful greatness. All for your glory. All for your kingdom. We remember those words that you taught your disciples through Jesus, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done,
on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Our hymn of preparation is hymn number 419. Would you take a hymnal and stand as you are able and join us in singing? Seated. Let us now worship God with his tithes and our offerings. Let us pray. Gracious God, receive these, your tithes and our offerings. Allow them to be multiplied within this church so that we may be able to further your kingdom and hasten your return. It's in your Son's precious name that we pray and ask these things. Amen. please remain standing as we read our scripture passage from Paul's first letter to the church in Corinth. Paul, called to be an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, and our brother Sosthenes, to the church of God that is in Corinth, to those who are sanctified in Christ Jesus, called to be saints together with all those who in every place call on the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, both their Lord and ours. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I give thanks to my God always for you because of the grace of God that has been given you in Christ Jesus. For in every way you have been enriched in him, in speech and in knowledge of every kind. Just as the testimony of Christ has been strengthened among you, so that you are not lacking in any spiritual gift as you wait for the revealing of our Lord Jesus Christ. He will also strengthen you to the end, so that you may be blameless on the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is faithful. By him you were called into the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
And may the peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
I welcome you once again, members and visitors. We are so glad that you're here with us today. There's a red pew pad at the center aisle. Please register your attendance with us. And as you greet one another and welcome each other, I invite the children to come forward for our children's message.
Mr. Bergen, how we doing, buddy? You having a good morning? You look good. Hey, guys, don't forget to tie your shoes. Good morning. Hey, Meg, how you doing? Hey, buddy, how you doing? You doing all right? Good deal. Miss Hudson, how are you? Hey, guys, come on up. How we doing? Yeah, pull them up. There we go. All right. Well, good morning, guys. How y'all doing? Have you ever heard your moms or your dads or maybe your grandmoms or your granddads mention the idea of responsibility? What do they say? You don't know? They have said it? Okay, you know they've said it. What do you think responsibility might mean? What? Okay, well, maybe something you have to take care of. Maybe you might have a duty to do something or maybe control over something. Maybe that's right. What happens when we don't do our responsibility? All right. Well, that sounds fantastic. I tell you, you got it all together. You know, we're just ready to pray now. You know, so. Well, one of the things, one of the things when it comes to responsibility that we have, you might have some at your house, but we also one of the ways that we might be responsible for the world around us is maybe to help those that might be in need. And so, one of the things we might do is maybe pray for people who are not feeling well. And what else? What we might do? What can we do with people who are hungry? Maybe someone doesn't have any food? Yeah, we can maybe give them some food. Well, we could. We can help them there. We can help people in need. So I want you, now this week, what I want you to do is I want you to find a way to help somebody that's around you, okay? Might be some friends, maybe somebody in your family. And one of the ways that we can be responsible is by helping them, okay? Can you do that? And I want you maybe tell me about it next week, all right? Well, let's pray and let's ask God to help us, all right? Oh God, we give thanks for today, and we give thanks for these who sit with me. Watch over them, oh God, we pray. What we all pray for ourselves, not just for them, oh God, is in those areas that that you lead us, where we're responsible for, things that you've given us as gifts, and part of what we do in receiving that is to use it in such a way that helps others, oh God. So watch over them, keep them safe, bless them, oh God. I pray this week as they just go about their life, that they'll be sensitive to what you might be doing inside of their life and how you might even be using them to give, whether it be in word or in deed, some level of image of your love for people. Watch over them, we pray again, and we ask this in the name of Christ. Amen. Many of you are aware of that song's history, and the writer of that hymn penned those words traveling across the Atlantic after experiencing great personal tragedy. I love the words of that hymn, to trust in God and to know that even in the face of all types of hardship and suffering and tragedy, that God is with us. Let's pray together. Oh, Lord, now as we continue to worship through using the text, what we pray, God, is that our minds would be open and that our hearts would be open to your Spirit, that you would use the reading of a text in such a way that it becomes the gospel. We know that that can't happen in our own ability, that in order for that to happen, your Spirit has to be a part of this. And so we earnestly pray for this, O God. And we ask this in the name of Christ. Amen. Now, last week we started a conversation where we were looking at some of the things specific to St. Paul. Mainly, what's our chief goal? What are we after? What do we seek to accomplish here? And that is to help people in some form or fashion mature in their faith. Now, what that means is that faith is dynamic, that faith is not stagnant, and people come in contact with us all different types of ways. And for some people, this maturation of faith will begin with very first steps, where someone is exposed to the gospel here and through the things that we're a part of, and the gospel begins to take root inside of their life, and they begin this process of growth, this process of maturation. It has a starting point here. For others, they come in contact with us, and they've been a part of this journey for a very long time. But through being a part of this place and open themselves further up to God, that their life grows, this faith matures inside of them. And now there are indications that we look for and to help us with this. And what we're after in how we design our ministries and worship and everything that has to do with St. Paul, what we want for people to do is we want them to see God for who God is. Now, we borrow that from the New Testament. Seeing in the New Testament, particularly the Gospels, is about comprehension. It's about understanding. It's about owning. So we want people to see God for who he is. And then we want people to trust God. To trust God to do what God says that he will do. And all this is possible because God reveals himself. God wants to be known. God reveals himself. And if you want to know what that looks like, just look to Jesus Christ. That's a culmination of God's revelation. We see it in this person, Jesus Christ. I don't know if you remember that when you were either a boy or a girl, I used to love brain teasers when I was a little boy. And I really liked the game where there was a picture of something and then the picture was covered. And the way the game played out is that bit by bit, there were parts of the picture that would be uncovered. And what you wanted to do is you wanted to be the first and the fastest to figure out what it was that was covered. And if you could name the picture or see it, and if you did it before anybody else, then you won the game. And that's a lot how Paul describes what God has done in Revelation when it comes to Jesus Christ. Little by little throughout history, God has just removed pieces that have covered something. And so people would see who God is and they would see this picture of Jesus Christ. And he does it for a purpose. God wants to be known. God wants to be in relationship with people. God wants people to own what he has revealed and then at the same time to enter into relationship, to have that infiltrate their hearts. The way the book of Romans describes it in the first couple of chapters is that God has revealed himself, and we look through a window and we see this revelation of God. And it becomes a part of who we are. And we are thankful for it. And then we respond in journeying with him. And so our purpose as people who belong to God, who are in connection with Jesus Christ, our purpose is to see what God does and then trust in him. And so we are a part of that. We create an environment here at St. Paul where we want that whole process to be easy. We don't want it to be difficult or to be hard. And actually, that's our responsibility. Responsibility is a good thing. You know, Peter Pan only works in the fairy tale. What happens when you don't grow up? It's ugly. What happens to our relationships when we refuse to grow up, to be responsible? What happens to our nature when we refuse to, when we forsake the responsibility? We live with no boundaries. We live where the world revolves around us, and we become incredibly selfish. And then when there are people that are around us that are connected to us in various ways, when all of a sudden they begin to put their finger on that, we blame them. Now, Peter Pan only works in the fairy tale. And so there's a part of what we've received from God that the way Paul describes it in the text, he says it's a gift. Now he's writing to this church in Corinth, and Corinth is not unlike any other church. There are people who have been a part of the gospel for day one in their life. They are very much a part of their church. And there are people that are a part of the gospel yesterday, and they are a part of the Corinth church. And then there are people who really don't know that much about Jesus and don't know that much about the gospel, but they know that there's something going on inside the Corinth church, and they want to be a part of it. The full spectrum is a part of the Corinth church. And Paul writes to them and says that you have received this charis of God, the Greek word for grace. You've received this grace from God. And most of the time in the church, in the Corinth church and inside of our church, whenever we talk about grace, what we really mean is that there's forgiveness. And we like that. But there's this whole other concept of grace that has to deal with giftedness. And we're responsible for that. Well, now, when the Corinth church, when they heard Paul and said, you've received this grace, and which means forgiveness, and at the same time, God has equipped you, God has gifted you, there was something inside the Corinth church that went, yes, we have. And so what they told everybody around them was that we've got the gifts and you don't. And because we've got the gift, we're better than everybody else. And there's a whole section of the Corinth letter that deals with that. Thankfully, that's not something that the church today struggles with. We struggle with the opposite of it. I'm not gifted at all. And we like the grace part when it talks about forgiveness. But this idea of understanding that part of what grace is that God has equipped us for something, what? That's not me. We don't struggle with what the Corinthians struggled with. See, our problem is the other side of that. That's not me. I'll take the forgiveness, but equipping? I don't know about that, God. And yet, what Paul is saying is that you have been gifted. He says you've been gifted in speech. You've been gifted in knowledge. What he's talking about is your life. Your life is a testimony, a witness, an example of what it's like to live in this world where we experience forgiveness and at the same time where we behold this giftedness that God has given us through His grace. Some of you are in Bible study with me throughout the week, and there's a Tuesday morning group and there's a Friday morning group, and we both groups have been studying the Gospel of John, and this particular week we were looking at John chapter 4. Some of you are aware of that passage. That's where Jesus leaves the Judean area and he travels north up into Samaria and he meets this woman who's at the well, and he has this conversation with this woman, and this woman knows about this much of the Gospel. Maybe about a thumbnail sketch. She knows a little bit about worship. Because whenever she has a conversation with Jesus, they start talking about what church has the right worship. Do we worship, is it right worship over here, or is it right worship over there? She knows just enough to, you know, what service has it right? And then she knows just enough about sacred text. In the North, they use these books of the Old Testament. In the South, they use these books of the Old Testament. And so she says, well, you know, we've got this, and y'all have got that. And, you know, we worship up here, and you worship down there. And I know enough about, that who's right. And she refers to him in the beginning as Mr. Jesus. And then she stays there a little bit longer. And she interacts with this Jesus. And it goes from Mr. Jesus to Prophet Jesus. And she stays there a little bit longer, has more of a conversation, more of experience with him. And by the time she leaves, he's not Mr. Jesus, and he's not Prophet Jesus. He's Savior of the world Jesus. I think that's how people process. They start somewhere with maybe about this much, and they stay with him for a while. Goes from Mr. Jesus to Savior of the world, Jesus. She receives this grace, forgiveness. She goes back to her community. You know what she does? She takes this grace that she's been given, this giftedness that she's received from God. You know what she does? She starts a church where she's the preacher, right? That's what John 5 is about, right? All the sermons she preached? No, that's not it. You know what she does? She joins the choir. She sings. She stands out in the middle of the city and she sings these hymns. That's John chapter 6, right? No, she doesn't do that either. She teaches. That's what she does. No, she didn't do any of that either. You know what she does? She goes back to the people she knows. And she says, this is who I am. And who I am today is because of this one I just met. This is what I hope to be tomorrow. There's going to be some growth that's going to take place. But you got to meet this guy. Who's making a difference in my life. You know how the text ends in John chapter 4? The community goes and they say to her, you know, we were intrigued because we saw you and you said, you know, you just talked about your life and that was just enough for us to go and meet this Jesus. And we believed a little because of what you said, but now that we've met him, see, we appreciate what you've done, but now that we've met him, we believe that much more. That's it. And you're responsible for that. And so am I. See, we think that when it comes to following Christ and what that means with our responsibility, we think that means we have to get it perfect. That's the other place down the road. That's not us. It's about just giving yourself to Jesus, and if it's Mr. Jesus today, that's fine. If it's Prophet Jesus tomorrow, that's fine too. And if somewhere down the road we're open to the fact that it's going to be Jesus, Savior of the world, then so be it. I don't think people are really concerned with about us being perfect. I think people are more concerned of someone that says, this is me with all the cracks that exist. But I'm learning to live with this God who offers me grace, which means I'm learning to live with forgiveness. and to allow that to work its way through my life, and somehow that's going to end up with not just forgiveness from God, but me forgiving myself, and that's going to have its way to where then I forgive other people, and it's not all worked out here, but I'm on this journey, and it's going to end, I know, at some point, or maybe there is perfection. But until then, this is who I am. And this is what I'm about. That's incredibly attractive. I don't need someone to be a part of my life and say, Shane, I've got it all together. Because sometimes I don't. I need an example of someone who's along the way and can share what it's like to be along the way. That's hopeful for me. I'll never forget when I was, when Caroline, my youngest, was two. I know she wasn't three. We lived in Vienna, Georgia, which is about an hour south of Macon. And Brooke called me one day and said, you need to come home for lunch. It was my birthday, and she said, you need to come home for lunch. And wouldn't really tell me what was going on. Just said, but when you get close, call me. And because I knew they were probably doing something. And all morning, Caroline was baking a cake. First time. So Brooke just set everything out, and Caroline was mixing all the batter and getting that ready, and they made the icing, and they got all that ready, and they baked it in the oven, and out it came, and then she covered it with the chocolate icing, and she had a bright idea that it's not just candles, we need sprinkles. So we had this big container, about yay big. I bet it had about 10 million sprinkles in it. 5 million made it on the cake. The other five, it took us a year to clean up. I mean, for a year, and we found there were sprinkles that were in the bedroom. I had no idea how they got there. Sprinkles everywhere. And Brooke said, now you call when you pull into the carport, garage. And the way the house was set up is you walk through the garage and you came into this kind of mud room is what we called it. And then around the corner, there was the kitchen. And she said, when you get ready, you call us. And Caroline was 2-year-old, one of those little half ladders that you use in the kitchen. And she was standing up on this half ladder, and she was grabbing hold of the handles, and the cake was in front of her, and she had her little apron on, and she was just waiting for her daddy to come around the corner. And when I came around the corner, she yelled, what? Happy birthday, you know? She was a terrible baker. That cake, whew, she's not here. She's down at Children's Church. It was the best thing in the world, you know. There was cake everywhere. Batter was everywhere. Chocolate was everywhere. Sprinkles were everywhere. But I still remember it. And I'll never forget it. See, the idea that thinks we have to be perfect and get it all together before we're going to be useful, that's never going to exist. And what Paul is getting at in the text is two things. You've been given grace, and that means forgiveness. And the second thing is, you've been given grace, and that means equipment. Where you've been equipped to be a witness of what you've experienced. And that means for some of y'all, you're going to bake the cake, and it's going to be beautiful. And it's going to taste good. And for somebody else, you're going to bake the cake, and it might be edible, but it's still useful. And we're responsible for both. It's not about being perfect, friends. It never will be. It's about living with the grace of God that ends up making you what is needed for people to get an image of what it's like to live with this grace-given God. Peter Pan does not work in the real world, nor does he work, or she work, in the church. We have a responsibility to live with this grace and to be a witness of it. Don't forsake your responsibility of the grace that you've given, been given by God. You've been forgiven. And you've been equipped. Now go and live as one who follows Christ. Oh God, as we hold what you've given us, this grace, help us not to run from it. Help us to embrace your forgiveness and also to embrace the responsibility. Even if it is only Mr. Jesus now, because we're holding on to the fact that one day it's going to be Savior of the world, Jesus. What we want is just to follow you. And so we pledge ourselves to you this morning. And we pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Our hymn of consecration, you'll find it's hymn number 430. O Master, let me walk with thee. I want to invite you to stand as you're able as we sing this hymn together. Hymn number 430. Otis is here to unite with the membership of our congregation. The last time, it's what I told him earlier, I said, the last time you were in front of me and I asked you questions, respond the same way I do. All right? So will you be faithful to the United Methodist Church with your prayers, your presence, your gifts, and your service, and your witness for the transformation of the world? If so, answer.
I do.
There we go. Fantastic. we want to give you an opportunity after the benediction to meet Otis and some of you, I know him, but it'd be good for him to see you again. Receive this benediction now. May the Lord bless and keep you. May the Lord be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his face and his countenance and give you rest in peace.